A Tale of the Good Old Times from Pearl Fishing by Charles Dickens. An alderman of the ancient borough of Beetlebury and churchwarden of the parish of St. Wulfstan's in the said borough, Mr. Blenkinsop might have been called, in the language of the 16th century, a man of worship. This title would probably have pleased him very much, it being an obsolete one, and he entertaining an extraordinary regard for all things obsolete or thoroughly deserving to be so. He looked up with profound veneration to the griffins which formed the waterspouts of St. Wulfstan's church, and he almost worshipped an old boot under the name of a blackjack, which on the affidavit of a forsworn broker he had bought for a drinking vessel of the 16th century. Mr. Blenkinsop even more admired the wisdom of our ancestors than he did their furniture and fashions. He believed that none of their statutes and ordinances could possibly be improved upon, and in this persuasion had petitioned Parliament against every just or merciful change which, since he had arrived at man's estate, had been made in the laws. He had successively opposed all the Beetlebury improvements, gas, waterworks, infant schools, mechanics institute, and library. He had been active in an agitation against any measure for the improvement of the public health, and being a strong advocate of intramural interment, was instrumental in defeating an attempt to establish a pretty cemetery outside Beetlebury. He had successfully resisted a project for removing the pig market from the middle of the high street. Through his influence, the shambles, which were corporation property, had been allowed to remain where they were, namely, close to the town hall and immediately under his own and his brethren's noses. In short, he had regularly, consistently, and nobly done his best to frustrate every scheme that was proposed for the comfort and advantage of his fellow creatures. For this conduct he was highly esteemed and respected, and indeed his hostility with any interference of disease had procured him the honor of a public testimonial, shortly after the presentation of which, with several neat speeches, the cholera broke out in Beetlebury. The truth is that Mr. Blenkinsop's views on the subject of public health and popular institutions were supposed to be economical, though they were in truth desperately costly, and so pleased some of the ratepayers. Besides, he withstood ameliorations and defended nuisances and abuses with all the heartiness of an actual philanthropist. Moreover, he was a jovial fellow, a boon companion, and his love of antiquity leaned particularly towards old ale and old port wine. Of both of these beverages he had been partaking rather largely at a visitation dinner, where, after the retirement of the bishop and his clergy, festivities were kept up till late under the presidency of the deputy registrar. One of the last to quit the crown and mitre was Mr. Blenkinsop. He lived in a remote part of the town, whither, as he did not walk exactly in a straight line, it may be allowable, perhaps, to say that he bent his course. Many of the dwellers in Beetlebury High Street, awakened at 12:30 on that night by somebody passing below singing, not very distinctly, "With a jolly full bottle let each man be armed," were indebted, little as they may have suspected it, to Alderman Blenkinsop for their serenade. In his homeward way stood the Market Cross, a fine medieval structure supported on a series of circular steps by a groined arch, which served as a canopy to the stone figure of an ancient burgess. This was the effigies of Wynkyn de Voques, once mayor of Beetlebury and a great benefactor to the town, in which he had founded almshouses and a grammar school, A.D. 1440. The post was formerly occupied by St. Wulfstan, but de Voques had been removed from the town hall in Cromwell's time and promoted to the vacant pedestal, vice Wulfstan demolished. Mr. Blenkinsop highly revered this work of art, and he now stopped to take a view of it by moonlight. In that doubtful glimmer, it seemed almost lifelike. Mr. Blenkinsop had not much imagination, yet he could well nigh fancy he was looking upon the veritable Wynkyn, with his bonnet, beard, furred gown and staff, and his great book under his arm. So vivid was this impression.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.